Episode 38. Sugar Shane, Dave Dookie, Tyler Kasha. Coming to you from the Legends Room here in Central Florida. Going to do a little bit of a review for you on these first three rounds of Supercross. Had another mutter again last night in San Diego. The throwback theme, which I want to get you guys' opinion about that. But we've had three rounds now in both the lights and in the 450s with three different winners. So we're going to talk about some of those different things and go over our opinions on them and see what you guys think. Feel free to comment in the comments on YouTube. Make sure you subscribe to the YouTube channel. Tell your friends to subscribe to the YouTube channel. And we greatly appreciate that. But let's start off with, we've had Anaheim 1 now, which was a nice dry race. But like we've talked about already in the A1 review, can't really put a whole lot of credit into A1 with the nerves and being the first race jitters and seeing where you stack up and figuring out where your bike is as far as race pace goes. So you can't put a whole lot into A1. Then we have an absolute mutter in San Fran. Complete mutter, canceled a lot of the practices and the qualifying out there. And then San Diego, press day goes nice and dry, even though Jet has a big get-off, which we can talk about that on press day. And then the rain comes on Saturday. They get through one basically dry qualifying session, and then they try and salvage the track, so they canceled the qualifying, and then San Diego turns into another mutter. Not quite as deep and sloppy as San Francisco, but still another mutter. So, I mean, you go three rounds, and each round has something that you could say there's a glitch or there's a reason why you shouldn't be overly concerned with your results. And speaking of results, I mean, the results of this stuff has been all over the place. I mean, Shane, Duke, Tyler, give me your input. I mean, let's do a quick overview of the first three rounds here. Tell me where are you seeing?
That was a long-winded intro.
Yeah, a lot to go over.
No, I'm just messing with you. Anaheim 1, I mean, I don't know. You know, that obviously that was a dry track, and it was interesting. I kind of let that one go. I was hoping for this weekend to be dry.
Yeah, me too.
After last weekend, but this track was pretty rideable. It was manageable. I mean, obviously people were struggling with how slippery it was, but at the same time, like, you know, like a lot of people say that it's kind of, you know, the mud race is kind of boring and, you know, they all look like beginners or whatever out there, but it is making it more interesting with the results, because honestly, the results have been crazy different every weekend.
They have,
you know,
absolutely. I mean, trying to have, you know, the lineup and making your picks. I mean, they're all over the
just
place.
Just throw my picks in the trash.
I think everybody, you know, I mean, you get the guy that ends up, you know, in a start around the 10th place spot. Last night in San Diego, he ends up winning the race in the 250 class. You know, I mean,
yeah.
Thrasher had a great race, so we'll talk about that. But Duke, what's your thoughts? I mean, are you on the same page that can you put much credit in these first three rounds?
No, but you can't judge. You know, it takes 3 to 5 rounds. That's what Ricky keeps saying, and I, for things to get sorted out, may take longer because of the last two. But Anaheim is just hype. First race of the season. Blah blah blah. You can win it or you can lose it. Everybody was pretty mellow. We've seen that.
Yeah.
Second race, we didn't expect what we got, and it was a survival. But who can ride? You got to ride it. The track's same for everybody.
Right.
Third round, I thought it might rain. I watched the weather pretty heavy, and when it started raining, I called you right away and said it's raining.
Yeah.
And it came down pretty hard, but it was a dip. It's because it's so hard packed. It was, you know, slick.
Yeah.
And that, again, it separates the real riders, you know. You need a lot of, you know, body control and balance. And I think it's sorting it out, and the good guys are coming to the top. Like, late in the race, Coop was coming.
Right.
It took him 15 minutes to get it, you know, or 10 minutes to get it sorted out, but here he come.
Right.
And he was coming.
No, I definitely think that you still, you know, the cream still rises to the top. But when you look at this, you know, these three rounds, three different races with three different winners in both classes, mm-hmm. not just in one, both, yeah. You know, I mean, that's,
and I honestly feel that that's going to continue. You know, I think Shimoda is going to eventually get it together. I think I still truly believe that that Hunter could put a race together. Even Barcia. I mean, I think that, you know, even with a dry track, I think that you can possibly get another different winner next weekend.
Yeah, well, and good thing for Barcia this weekend, getting the podium and getting the third place finish. That's cool for him. I know everybody's been struggling with talking about being sick because of the weather. You know, that's one thing they mentioned multiple times in the broadcast is the amount of people that are sick because it's rainy and you chilled versus getting hot and riding in the rain and racing. But for this specific race last night in San Diego, what was your guys' thoughts on the throwback?
Yeah, which one was your favorite?
I know which one yours was, Tyler.
No, you don't.
Yeah, I do.
Because I'm going to tell you right now which one it was.
Okay, tell me.
The Twisted T Suzuki, that Brian Swink era.
Chisholm with the big S on the on the radiator shroud.
Yeah, that was sick.
That was pretty cool.
That did look cool.
Yeah.
I think, you know, the Yamaha throwback, I'm not a huge fan of.
No. Because like what we were talking before we came on air, throwback didn't have pink wheels or whatever color they are. It didn't have, you know, pink mufflers.
Yeah.
That's not throwback.
Well, like I said,
that's modern.
Like I said, if Willy Wonka builds a dirt bike for the Oompa Loompas, that's what he would build.
Exactly. Oh, I totally agree. Hey, the Hondas look sick. The Hondas are pretty
cool. The Hondas did not look sick.
Yeah, I was not a big fan.
I think they looked as close as anything.
To the Elsinore.
Yeah.
The 74th time they've run Elsinore graphics or an Elsinore redo for those Hondas. It's like, you had a perfect opportunity to run something more modern, like along the lines of the Suzuki team, and we're just back to silver tank.
Yeah, but that's throwback.
How throwback you want to go? We're going like ancient history.
Well, it's throwback. They've done the Woody Woodpecker thing. They've done the Jeremy McGrath 1-800 collect, which somebody did this weekend.
Justin Starling did.
Justin Starling, his, two other guys, and their clothing was spot on.
Jet had some pretty cool gear.
The gear was cool.
The gear was cool. But I'll say one of the teams that I was a little bit let down by as far as getting into the vibe of the throwback was Kawasaki.
Kawasaki.
Yeah. I mean, it's like they didn't even try.
Mm-hmm. No, they didn't, and they have a retro model in production.
Yeah.
So I expect Yamaha to run with their 50th anniversary deal. It's unfortunately, though, it's been done, right? Washougal last year.
Right.
They had an opportunity to do something different. I think it's not a hard guess that they would go with the bike that is in production. Kawasaki has a throwback bike in production and chose to ignore it, which was really strange.
They should all be.
Is that the one with the purple and pink KX on the side?
Yeah.
I think Chad was the first one to ever do that on our Kawasaki's. It looked awesome.
Yeah, and that to me, there was another, you know, social media post with the amount of different people that I follow online that someone said that even old Freddie Norn with the number 22 should have done a throwback to the discount tire Cowie day.
Sure.
Maybe
Kawasaki just has bigger fish to fry right now with the results and, you know, and their performance, and they're just not worried about that throwback stuff.
Maybe. I don't know. Tough week for Kawasaki, though, with Max Volan, you know, taking a practice crash during the week and not being able to race San Diego. I'm not sure the extent of the injury. I didn't follow up with it.
You hear the...
I'm not really talking about Pro Circuit.
I'm talking... But it is Kawasaki in general.
Yeah. But, I mean...
Well, another thing that we were talking about before we came on air and one of the questions that Tyler brought up, which is a great question, but with this El Nino cycle that we're in right now, California's obviously been getting some rain. It's clear the last two races have been mudders. How many more mudders do we see this year?
Yeah, I bring that up because we're even having trouble here in our state for the amateur races, right? Like,
right.
It's almost a guaranteed... It's going to rain at least once a week at some point right now. It's an extremely wet winter.
Yeah.
And how is that going to impact the Supercross season? Because you have an opportunity here to have an unprecedented amount of mud races. I mean, we're always going to go indoors eventually.
Yeah.
But
first one will be Detroit, not next weekend because we go back to A2, but the weekend after Detroit. That'll be your first indoors.
If Anaheim 2 is dry, I'll feel a lot better. But if it's another mud race, I'm going to start really wondering.
Yeah.
Well, Monday in Anaheim, tomorrow in Anaheim is 100% chance of rain.
Nice.
But the rest of the week it looks all right. So I think.
But we all know that can change.
It can change. Way. It can change. But that's why I looked it up just now, because you know there's a possibility it might be another mudder next weekend.
Right. Absolutely.
Yeah. Well, the one that we know is not going to be a mudder is going to be the following weekend when they go to Detroit, because Detroit's in a dome. So that one we know will be dry. So we'll look forward to that one. We're looking forward to all of them, but it's tough for me to really put a grip right now on who's your elite in each class, because every race there's been something that you could say, hey, don't worry about it. Shake this one off.
Yeah.
Get through it.
Consistency.
But honestly, the weather affects the East Coast, or you know, the northern races as well, because if that dirt that they're putting in there is covered in snow right now,
yeah,
like a lot of times it was in Canada, they just left it outside. It just becomes the track's a sponge.
Yeah.
You know, so even some of the indoor races have been actually look just like this track, just because of where they store the dirt.
Yeah. Very possible. Didn't think about that one. But we go through these first three rounds. Anaheim won. Hampshire, you know, gets a pretty dominating win. Looks like he's going to be, you know, one of the favorites, if not the favorite in the lights class. And then just has a tough time in the mud at San Fran and San Diego. I mean, last lap of the main event. And they even talked about it. JT made a comment about when you're in those conditions, overriding the track can really bite you. And it was last lap. He was trying to go for, you know, pass, trying to work his way forward, and just looked like he was pushing too hard. And on that track, in those conditions, you can't push that hard. And it ended up costing.
In that instance, wasn't Smith right there too? When that happened? Wasn't
Smith, right behind Hampshire?
Yeah,
I think so, because he slipped into third.
But he went off the track.
Yeah, in the whoops.
Yeah. Did you ever notice when they went off the track in the whoops, they didn't get back on in the whoops? They went all the way down
to the end.
I don't know if RJ was rushing because of the guys in front of him or the guy behind him, you know?
Yeah, well, trying to get in front of the guy with the red plate, you know?
Yeah.
But that's the thing that we were talking about before we went on air is, you know, we were just having our sidebar conversation. Obviously, we've got the race playing on the big screen, you know, just as we're going through it. But, you know, you got to beat the guy with the red plate to gain points.
Right.
But you also got to think about championship implications. You know, you got to settle down and take what the race is going to give you. And if in these scenarios that he's had two bad mud races, you know, if he would just stay on two wheels and get through the race, you know, focus on the big picture, not just the race. If that makes sense.
We can say that.
Yeah.
As spectators and what have you, that's when like the mechanic and the management needs to step in. But it's hard when you're out there and you're thinking, you don't think about that.
Yeah.
You tip over, I got to get up, got to get up. Red plate guy goes by you.
Yeah.
Then the panic button.
Yeah. Now your mind's racing.
Not only that, and they don't really talk about it, but it's more of like a higher pressure situation for the lights class, because they don't have as many races. They only have half the dang races. So, one mistake is double the cost, you know?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. No, and I think it shows in the points and the overall points, which we'll talk about towards the end. But going over, San Diego press day, did you see the get off from Jet?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was a pretty tough one.
Yeah. What do we think happened? Are we leaning towards just what would make you go long? Was he going for the what was that, a triple?
Was that a triple or a quad?
Quad. It was a table single, so he was trying to skip one, basically. I'll call it a quad if you want, but
yeah, so that would be considered a quad.
Wheel spin.
And then he pogoed, sticked it.
So was he going for
not
it?
Not even close.
Or was he?
Oh, he wasn't close.
Did he lose where he was on the track? Did he? What happened? Do we think
wheel spin, going up the jump before it?
Well, wheel spin would have resulted in him trying to go for that line. Had he done it previously?
I don't know.
Not sure.
All I got was the highlight of him, you know, blowing his hands off the bars. And
yeah, if he had done it previous laps, that's one thing, right? You got wheel spin or whatever. But if that was the first time that he had attempted that line, then what was his reason for that happening?
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know if he was just going for it, because all I saw was the one clip of it actually happening when they showed it. And to me, it looked like he was going for it and just came up super short. I don't think he overjumped, you know,
the triple
that far. I think he just underjumped what he was going for with wheel spin, not getting the drive because of it being slick and light rain or whatever that was going on. But I'm surprised he was able to race, to be honest with you. I mean, when I saw that crash or that clip on social media, I was like, oh, man.
Yeah, especially when he was kind of messing with his wrist or whatever. It's a good dang thing his hands did fly off, in my opinion.
Yeah. I know they said on air they just jammed his thumb, but that could have been a lot worse.
I think that put him in the panic mode for Saturday night then.
Yeah, it could have.
And that's one reason why he had the issue at the end of the night.
Yep, which we'll go into that. We talked about the lights, three different winners. You know, Hampshire at A1, Jordan Smith wins San Francisco, gets a pretty good gap points-wise, runs the red plate, salvages in San Diego with basically RJ going down and getting gifted the third place spot there with Hampshire going down in the last lap. So not a bad, as far as consistency, like you're talking about, not a bad three races for Smith. But then how about Nate Thrasher? You know, now Nate Thrasher yesterday, I think on lap one was somewhere around like seventh or eighth place or something like that, and then just slowly worked his way all the way up to the front and got there and battled with those guys all the way till the end and gets the checkered flag. So
they had mentioned that a lot of his race wins have come in the mud. I didn't know he was kind of like a mud guy. Wasn't aware of that.
I wasn't either, but Thrasher not having the best, you know, round one, yeah. You know, so he's way back in points but gets the win. Then you had RJ who won round one and then has two bad races, so it slides him back all the way to fourth in points. And then Jordan Smith, who's just kind of sitting here staying consistent, being up there on the box each weekend, you know, maintains that number one plate going into Anaheim 2. So that's pretty cool in the lights class. And then you go to the 450s, and anybody that follows us on our Instagram can already see that we put a, you know, good ride cowboy to our buddy AP. We spent some time with AP in Tampa last year and in Nashville, put a picture up of my son and myself with AP and Seth Rarick in Tampa last year, and just such an awesome guy. And that's why I think the stadium just erupted. I mean, even my mom texted me and she was like, oh my gosh, so heartwarming and great to see the amount of riders come up to AP after the race and to get that Detroit debacle off his back and finally get his win. And how about this? Goes into Anaheim 2 with the red plate. First time ever in his 450 career.
Yeah.
He's going to go into Anaheim 2 with the red plate.
Well, that's not just due to last night. The guy has been up there since the beginning of this season. So, he started off the season the best he ever has.
Consistency.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I think I was the only one that called him in the top five at Anaheim 1, and he did. You know, yeah. Got fourth at A1. So, like you said, being there and having that consistency, and it's amazing to me to watch three different races in the 450s and three different winners there. I mean, obviously Jet wins a dry A1, Sexton survives the mudder in San Fran, and then, you know, AP gets his San Diego win. So three wins. So we've talked about that in both classes. Who do we think is going to be the next winner? I mean, I do see this year could be a more...
Chase Sexton.
Well, he's already won one.
Going to win at A2.
Well, I'm not calling our picks for A2 right now. I'm saying, who do you think could be another winner?
I definitely think that we will see Tomac and Cooper Whip have a win.
Yep, absolutely.
Yeah, I could definitely see...
I think Hunter Lawrence is going to win one.
Yeah, maybe. I mean, they did make comment on the show last night that, if you remember, Dazzy made the comment at the beginning of their 250 days that they were working through the bike, trying to get some things figured out. The same thing is happening right now on a 450. I mean, if you think about it in Hunter's standpoint, that was his third race ever.
Lawrence even said that. That's who said it last night.
On a 450, you know? So, I mean, these guys are working through the 450 just like they did in their first year or two on the 250s. And once they get that thing dialed in exactly how they want it or the way they want it set up, I think you could see both of those guys become, you know, more consistently to the top But I definitely agree in the 450 class. I wouldn't count Tomac out.
I think the Suzuki will get one.
Webb could be there.
Yeah. Not a bad guess.
Kenny's definitely a name to put in the mix. And to be honest with you, JA's not looking bad. You know, JA21's fighting with those guys, and he's staying up there pretty consistent too, sitting fourth in points right now. He's actually tied for fourth in points with Cooper Webb. So, you know, those guys are there. I definitely think there's a chance for a win, possibly multiple winners still to come in the 450 class. And then you go down to the lights class too. We've had Hampshire, Smith, and Thrasher. I wouldn't count out Shimoda. I think when you let him get in the right conditions and continue to work on that 250, I think Shimoda's a contender. And then the other one for me would be Kitchen. Mm-hmm. You know, and then honestly, last night, Marchbanks could have got it. Marchbanks was close.
Yeah.
You know, so I mean, you've got Marchbanks, Kitchen, Shimoda, even Oldenburg had a good heat race going before the red flag.
I was about to say that Oldenburg brought the fire last night.
He was pretty shook. I think he
got fifth, right? Overall last night?
I'll have to look and see.
I'm pretty sure. He got fifth. They were showing it on the TV there, but yeah, he came alive last night.
Yeah, and he was riding great until that red flag came out, and then the restart just totally got him. But you know, I was gonna say Volan, but now Volan with his crash this week, he's out. But I definitely think Kitchen, Mark Bakes, maybe even Oldenburg could be in there. But looking at these points right now on both of these classes after three rounds, I know consistency is what Dookie's said multiple times on this episode. And I agree, consistency is the key. But if you look at the 250 points, Jordan Smith, and a little bit of a gap, he's got 67 points. Levi Kitchens in second, being pretty consistent with 59 points. March Banks moves up into third with his finish with 57 points. RJ slides down to fourth with 54 points. And then and then Mitchell Oldenburg sits in fifth at 41 points.
He got seventh last night.
So seventh. Between first and fifth, you already have a 26-point swing between first and fifth. I mean, that's a one-race swing between the top five guys. Now, let's talk about who's not in the top five in the 250 class that are people we've all mentioned on multiple episodes. Shimoda sits in seventh with 36 points. Juju Bomber sits in 10th with 33 points. Nate Thrasher, the winner of last night's race, sits in 12th with 30th points because of his crash at A1. Ryder DeFrancisco sits in 13th with 28 points. Phil Nicoletti sits in 17th with 18 points because his bike member wouldn't run at A1. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And then sitting in 23rd in points that I personally thought was going to have a better year or be higher up in the points after three rounds, Talon Hopkins sits in 23rd with 7 points.
Yeah, something's wrong with that program there, why he got demoted, or if he did get demoted, whatever it was. But the guys that are low had one good race, and then when the conditions set in, they went to grab it, other than Thrasher.
Yeah, well, Thrasher and Nicoletti, A1 is what cost them.
Yeah.
You know, the bike not being able to fire for Nicoletti at A1, and then Thrasher's crash at A1.
Couldn't stay on the bike.
Yep, so those two definitely, but just some surprising names, you know, pretty far down the list that you wouldn't really consider.
I don't think Hawkins, I mean, the guy's still a rookie.
Basically, yeah.
You know, and I think he's going to have to, on the program he's on, he's going to have to put up results. But it's still the beginning of his career, and I think we've seen him. He's got speed.
Yeah. Is he back over here training?
I'm not sure where he's training at.
I don't think he is. So if you're not over here, then you're not part of that.
Yeah, no.
Factory bunch, because he was Husqvarna factory.
Right.
Yeah. Well, then you look at the 450 points. AP, with the win last night, takes over the red plate with 60 points, sitting right behind him in second with 1 point difference, his teammate, Sexton, with 59 points. Jet sits right behind them with 56 points. Jason Anderson sits in fourth, tied with Cooper Webb for fourth. 49 points.
That's it?
Yeah, 49 points. So you're talking about 11 points between them. And also, I just looked this up. I'm looking at it on my phone as we speak. Dylan Ferrandis is tied with them as well with 49 points.
In the top five every race.
So fourth place, Jason Anderson, Cooper Webb, and Dylan Ferrandis are all tied with 49 points. So that's six people within 11 points.
Well, that's going to break up next weekend for sure.
And sitting right behind them in seventh place, Eli Tomac with 48 points. And then you have Ken Roczen in eighth with 42 points, Barsha with 40 points, and then in 10th place, 35 points is Prado. But I think
he's done.
He's done. That was his last race. He was only doing the first three.
Went home this morning, they said.
Okay. So he'll be out of it after that. But then again, even in the 450 class, look at some of these factory names on this list.
Barsha, 10th.
Yep. Barsha sitting in 9th with 40 points. 11th, Adam Cincirillo with 33 points. Hunter Lawrence sitting in 13th with 27 points. Justin Cooper sitting in 15th. That puts him at 22 points. Malcolm Stewart sitting in 17th with 14 points. Christian Craig sitting in 18th with 12 points. Then you go all the way down to Kyle Chisholm, our good buddy right here from Tampa, Florida, number 11 on the Hep Suzuki, 4 points, sitting in 25th.
Well, it's not in the 450 class, that doesn't really surprise me because almost the whole line is factory guys.
Yeah.
You know, there's not a – they're all out there still. So.
Chiz is a workhorse.
You know, for those guys to be in the teens, in the points, like, it doesn't surprise me because – there's a lot of them out there.
Yeah, I would say a couple of surprises in here. Shane McElrath sitting in 12th. You know, that's pretty good for Shane. Derek Drake sitting in 16th place in points.
Last night.
Yeah, he did. Cade Cleason, you know, Freddie Norin, even our buddy Benny Bloss, you know, he's sitting back there in 23rd place, but man, like you said, I mean, there's almost like 15 factory guys in that class.
Where's Mookie?
Malcolm's sitting back in 17th with 14 points.
He's been all over the track.
Well, he got a DNF in San Francisco.
Yeah.
You know, so when you get no points, that doesn't help at all.
Right.
So it'll be interesting to see, you know, how Anaheim 2 goes. And like Shane said, with the weather, you know, that can change by any minute. But hopefully right now it's looking like it's dry. But how about two different situations from the 450 main event stand out to me that seem to be the hottest topics all over social media this morning. Number one, the Jet and Jason Anderson. You know, you can see when AP is celebrating after his race and, you know, everybody's giving him a hug in the background.
They stole the poor guy's thunder.
Yeah.
Again, I think that's the poor coverage that we're getting.
Yeah. I could see that.
They're like, what? Oh, look at this. What's going on in the background.
Poor coverage.
Yeah. And I noticed.
Hey, you know how you wouldn't have saw that if Plessinger would have gone to the podium.
Yeah, which makes he gets interviewed by his bike and not on the podium. I don't get that.
Because
he was down there celebrating.
He was dancing.
Yeah, exactly what he was doing.
He wanted to put on a dance clinic before, you know, but, you know, with the TV time schedule, they had to put the microphone in front of his face and get her done, you know?
Yeah.
Ghost Rider. He had to ghost ride it.
Yep, ghost ride the whip.
How do we feel about ghost riding factory bikes? I'm okay with it.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
It's going to be new again tomorrow anyhow.
Yeah, what's it gonna do? Bend the bars?
Exactly.
Yeah, endless amounts of bars.
Well, what'd you think? What was your take on the Jet and Jason Anderson thing? Did you see during the broadcast they had it split into two screens?
Right.
And the bottom screen kind of showed Jason. I don't want to say toying with Jet, but in a sense, yeah, you know, kind of toying with Jet. I mean, looks like he was slowing up in some of the turns, almost brake checking him a bit, and then they came over the face of one of the jumps, and it looks like, you know, Jason cut over on him some, which I understand that track's slick and you're going to be all over the place. And it's going to be hard to avoid, you know, trying to maneuver your bike in those conditions. But once Jet got around him, he basically left him. You know, I mean, the time gap just, you know, went way up.
Well, Anderson's pretty consistent throughout the years of you know, he's a hard guy to pass, and he rides a wide track. And I don't know. I don't know if Jet wanted to just have a discussion with him, but he did put his hands on him first. I didn't know that until as of recent. Jason Anderson's not the guy that you put your hands on.
Yeah.
You know, and I think that's why the apology that Jet put up was soon to follow, because, you know, he's trying to make better with him, because he knows what I mean, we've seen it year after year with Anderson, with certain guys he gets into it with, and it continues throughout the season, and I don't think Jet wants that.
Yeah, so you think Jet was put the post up to try and save face a little bit, and not get cleaned out next week at A2?
A little bit, you know,
or
but I mean,
whipped in the parking lot.
But honestly, you know, is Jason the type of guy to be like, "Oh, dude, it's okay, bro. Like, you apologize. Oh, we're square." I don't think so.
No.
So I think the apology is kind of pointless.
The thing that I don't understand about the apology is, who is the one that was, per your request, wanting free tickets to the fan zone?
I think it was the AMA, the way he worded it.
You think it was AMA, or you think it was like Jason was like, "Yo, dude, make this better by giving me and my family some free"?
Maybe they don't want to go to his fan zone.
Maybe it goes back to the 21 and Barsha incident, where didn't Barsha buy some of that his swag that that he does?
Yep.
I don't
fried. He brought
He bought some team fried stuff.
Yep.
I don't know.
That's what Jason.
Well, it says
some of my swag.
It says at AMA Supercross, send me the invoice, and per your request, talking about the AMA, free passes to the fan zone for the season. And then, sorry, mate.
I don't know.
Maybe that makes me think it's a joke. Like he's apologizing, but he's not taking that seriously.
I don't know.
Which is fine. I mean, nobody expects an apology for racing anyway. But
I just hope Jet's neck's okay.
From getting his helmet yanked down.
I mean, Anderson almost pulled his head off.
He did.
And like I was telling Dookie before the show, I mean, whatever, you know, Jet put his hand on, you know, Anderson. But if somebody jerked my neck like that, I would, oh, man, it would have. That wouldn't have been good. And then a lot of the comments online are freaking Hunter just riding by. Like, well, see if it's your own battle, bud. Just went back to the truck.
Yeah.
Well, I don't want to see it become, and I think our sport is becoming the little bit of the NASCAR thing with the fines. And it's fine to have an argument. There should be no apologies in the racing thing, unless it's a blunt and blatant thing.
Yeah.
If that's what it was called for, nobody got hurt, no foul. They rode away. AMA let it go.
Yeah.
They're creating drama.
Well, it was similar.
They just need to get their shit together and cover what needs to be covered. They're not even covering the leaders. They're not covering the battles. You know what goes on in the pits after these guys ride off the track? That's what you cover.
Yeah.
Their coverage is really bad, and it's really stuck out to me.
Yeah.
That I could care less if those guys are going at it in the back.
Yeah.
Well, you know what, Duke? What you're missing is that's how the AMA makes money, is by those fines.
Oh, yeah. No, I know.
And there's obviously not a lot of income streams, so finding pro riders is one of the few.
Believe me, there's a ton of income stream that we have even no clue about. They charge for everything.
Well, it almost reminds me, do you remember back in football when they started banning players from having end zone celebrations?
Yep, yep.
And then they got rid of that rule and they started allowing it again?
Yeah.
That's what your fans want to see.
Exactly
right. We want to see the celebration after a big touchdown and a 50-yard run.
You should be able to celebrate after you scored a touchdown, you're 62 points down.
Yeah.
I think it's, yes, Tyler has a point about the revenue stream for the AMA or whatever. You think these boys give a crap about paying the AMA fine? Especially those two guys?
Yeah, I was going to say.
And
depends
again,
on who
it
is.
Probably doesn't come out of their pocket.
Depends on who.
Either Honda, well, even if it does come out of his pocket, like, fine me $500, big deal.
Yeah.
They seem to do it again, so the fine.
Like, is the AMA thinking, like, oh, we got him. You know, we got him. We find him.
Let's hit him where it hurts.
Yeah, let's hit him where it hurts, his pocket. Like, come on, dude.
I mean,
I think it hurts taking points away more than it does the money.
That's
where you hurt him. Hit him more. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, let's go on to the second incident of the night. Coop was coming. Coop was coming. I mean, you could see that time gap when they when Coop got into second, it was like 7 seconds back, and at one point he had it all the way down to, I want to say, like 1.9 seconds or something. And then they get around the KTM teammate of the leader. So Aaron Plessinger is leading the race. His teammate, the number one of Chase Sexton, basically lets AP by pretty easily. Just moves over to the straightaway, takes the outside line. AP takes the inside line, goes right by. Well, then Chase is now between AP and Webb. And he kind of goes outside in a turn, but then he cuts down and comes to the inside, which is the rut that Coop was taking. Mm-hmm. And Coop hits.
Yeah, Coop had a big inside line.
Yeah, and basically Coop hits Chase's bike.
Yeah, they made contact.
Coming out of that turn and completely slowed up, and the gap drops from 1.9 back to like 5.5 seconds on the final on the final lap.
Did they ever show that? This might be a thing about coverage, but did they ever repeat showing that on television? Because I saw it, but I never saw it repeated. I would like to see that video again.
I saw it
was way down in the screen,
because it's hard to make a comment about it without actually like studying the whole maneuver, you know?
Yeah, I saw it during the broadcast, but I never saw them replay it.
No,
and I haven't, you know, because it's obviously so early in the morning for us, for the people that are out in California.
Maybe Roger was like, don't replay that, you know? Do not show that to the public.
Well, here's my debate. You know, we remember the whole, was it the Chisholm Gate back in the day when he was on,
a long time ago,
on the same team with Chisholm Chad?
Gate. Chisholm yeah. Gate.
It was Chisholm and, was it Chisholm and Chad or Chisholm and Stu?
Well, wasn't he Chad's teammate, or was he Stu? He was Stu's teammate. And he was slowing up Chad.
Yeah. That's how if I remember correctly.
I mean,
yeah. They were on the San Manuel Yamaha teammates.
Do you think there was any team orders there at KTM?
Hell yeah.
Do you think so?
Absolutely. I would have done the same thing. Chase Sexton's a hero.
I don't know. I don't know if...
Now you're talking, buddy.
I don't know if there's team
taxes. Duke's game.
I don't know if there's team taxes with Chiz, because Chiz used to ride at Chad's track, and if that kind of stuff went on, Chad tell Chiz to freaking pound sand.
Well, that was just a reference to another time that we've seen it. You know, like when Chad, you know, held up Dungy for a lap. You know, those are just references to other times that I've seen.
I don't think that there's team tactics in this situation, because Chase wasn't expected to be in that position in the first place. You know, he's expected to be running up front or whatever, and he just happened to, you know, have a really, really bad day.
Isn't there a saying about making lemonade with lemons or something like that?
I mean, when you get put in the position.
if that was something that Chase did maliciously, he thought about that himself. They didn't put anything on the pit board like, hey, oh, dude, slow.
No, that's, no.
Like, that was a malicious maneuver by Sexton.
Yeah.
If that's the case, but I mean, you'll never find out.
In my opinion, it was a racing incident where the track was so slick, and he probably went up high.
I'm buying that one.
And because of the slickness of the track, he probably turned down on the rut earlier than he expected to, and just happened to cause.
You're pushing.
Or Chase knows that Coop's doing really good this year, and he wanted to screw him up a little bit, so he doesn't gain more points on him.
How does he even know he's there?
He's looking. Chase on TV was looking behind him the whole damn time.
He looked back over the finish line to see who was coming.
Yep.
Yeah.
He did.
Chase is a smart rider.
Oh, yeah.
He saw that coming, and he played out the entire scenario of how that was going to go.
I must have had blinders on.
You did. You did. Chase is thinking to himself, okay, my teammate, Plessinger, is out front, a crowd favorite.
Yeah, potentially going to get his first win.
I'm monitoring the gap of Cooper. I know that he is closing it very strong late in the race, obviously. And he does not want to go back to the KTM rig and have to see Plessinger's face after Cooper wins. So you know what? He handled it. Kamikaze mission. And he did what he needed to do for the team. And I think that probably just got him another 3-year deal.
No way. So Chase is out there on the track.
We are keeping you around.
So Chase,
you're the man.
I mean, I like your thought process, but I mean, is Chase really out there monitoring instead of racing?
Yeah.
Hey, well, Chase knows what's going on.
That's
he's
what Tyler
a.
Tyler said.
Well, the one thing that did do with Coop not being able to catch and pass AP because of that incident, which did it affect the outcome of the race? You'll never know. Strong chance, but you'll never know. But what happens? A, KTM gets the win. B, KTM still has the red plate.
A lot of positives here. Yep. With Chase.
Even Coop on the podium said that there's strange things going on out here.
Yeah. Not, and don't even
with lappers.
Don't even get me started with the history of KTM and Cooper Webb, right? They do not want Plessinger to lose this race. Lose it to anybody else.
To Cooper
Webb.
Do
not lose it to Cooper Webb.
I feel next weekend he's gonna lose it to Cooper Webb. Cooper Webb's he's knocking on the door of a win.
That's fine, but he got the win.
Yeah, and I think the one thing that does get me excited is that when you do something like that, now Coop's going to be fired up.
Yeah.
And a fired up Coop is a bad dude on a dirt bike.
So next weekend, we're going to see Chase on the ground, and we're going to see Jet Lawrence on the ground during the main event.
Done by Jason
Anderson. I'm thinking they're going to have a
Jason Anderson.
Yes.
Boxing ring in the middle.
These guys can't fight, dude.
Oh, I know that.
Yeah,
I'm gonna pull your helmet. I think
when Jason grabbed Jet's helmet, Jet's eyes probably got to be about that big and was like,
"It was an attention getter."
Maybe I should.
I mean,
chill out a little bit.
Maybe Jet, you need some donuts, dude.
Jet Lawrence does have the largest diameter neck on the line. I think he'd be all right.
Yeah. Well, that would be interesting because Australian guys are fighters, and I think guys from New Mexico out in the middle of the desert, they can scrap too. So that would be an
they
interesting.
They get bit by snakes and stuff. I don't even faze them.
No.
They're like Crocodile Dundee.
They're like honey badgers, yeah. You know?
Oh, that's a knife.
So do we try and throw any picks in on A2, or are we getting to the point where the picks are just so all over the place? Because
well,
I want to reverse on that really quick. I want to talk about, if we could, touch on one more thing from the race.
Okay.
And that was the obvious thought process of Tomac trying to get his lead lap back, and how he's, if you put it in perspective, okay, he is fast enough to run that lead, right? He's fast enough to essentially get Plessinger back. I don't know if the bike got bent up or what, but you know. So he gets lapped, and he is now forced to make the decision. Okay, do I continue to race to the front and get between? Suddenly, I'm the Chase Sexton in this scenario.
Yeah, where he's between him and his teammate Coop.
Or do we pass the leader back? Which, how many times has that happened?
Yeah,
that would have been weird. So he's forced to essentially make a decision. Do I just sit here and get in the way? Or do I relent my 10th place finish and just hope that the pace of these front runners carries me to 9th or further up?
Yeah, in my opinion on that, Tyler, watching the race, I never felt like he did anything that impacted the race.
I don't either.
Yeah, I think that AP got by him, and then he pretty much latched onto his rear wheel and stayed with AP for a while.
We're talking about Tomac, right?
Yeah, Tomac.
So Tomac didn't do his team tactic job at all.
No.
He should have yard-sailed Plessinger.
or at least tried to slow him up some, you know, take the main line, slow him up some. But I for me watching the race, I didn't see Tomac do anything that made any impact on.
I agree completely. I think that Tomac had thought about, do I go back by Plessinger? Because it looked like he was going to go. He was fast enough.
Yeah.
Once he got accustomed to the bent up bike, but then that's just going to look so weird. Like,
yeah. When have you ever seen a down rider pass the leader to try and get back?
And then what is so he essentially was. I feel like his hand was forced to set up his position, and I'll bet you he wishes he could have had that one back.
I don't know. You know, I mean, when you're following AMA and you've got a blue flag out there, it doesn't matter who you are. If you've got a blue flag, your job is to get out of the way of the race, you know, that's and not make an impact.
Yeah, Sexton.
In Sexton's case, he impacted the race, and Tomac didn't. But I do understand where you're coming from. I mean, Tomac definitely could have taken the main lines, could have put up a harder fight, had the speed. Once AP got around him, he stayed right there with him. I understand your thought process of, do I try to
get my lap back,
maybe even, you know, bump AP a little bit, have a small slowdown of AP so that Coop can get another advantage and try and catch up and get the win for the team. But
they're about to replay it right now.
Yeah.
Do I get in front of AP and then suddenly AP picks up the pace and now I'm back in the way? I mean, it was just a weird scenario that I feel like only Tomac.
I'm actually happy Chase had a bad weekend, because it makes it way more interesting for next weekend, because, you know, it's all scrambled up now, you know, with the points. And
that's the thing. When you look in the 250 class, we talked about the points gap between first and fifth right now is already at 26 points.
That's insane.
I mean, that's one race right there.
RJ Hampshire is obviously, he's a contender, but he's got a lot of work to do now.
Yeah.
You know, I was thinking about that, because you were right, Shane. There are just so few races that maybe he... I don't know if he's worried that he can't beat Jordan Smith, and when he saw them go by, he just was like, oh, this can't be happening. I don't have the longevity in the season to let these.
Well, the only reason Jordan Smith went by is because RJ went down.
But even
sorry,
if he
I meant behind him.
But even if he gets passed by Jordan Smith, if he just keeps it on two wheels, it's a hell of a lot more. The points wouldn't be where they're at right now.
Yeah. What's the reasoning to just put yourself in a situation where you completely throw it away?
Yeah, that's the bigger thing I was talking about at the beginning of the episode, is focusing more on the big picture. And I do understand, you know, Dookie's point, Shane's point. They have a shorter season. I fully understand that. So I can see some additional pressure because they're shortened season. They only have half the races. What is it, 7-8 races for the 250 guys? So... I could get that. I'm trying to see right here. So he ends up sixth on the night. If he stays on two wheels and just finishes the final lap, he probably would have gotten P3.
P3 or P4.
Yeah. So, you know, there's a couple point swing right there. But when you go back to making it interesting, and you talk about how stacked the 450 class is, when you go from first to seventh is a difference of 12 points. Versus the 250 class, first and fifth is a difference of 26 points. 12 points can be done in a change of any of these mud races, or even these guys' finishes at A1 when it was dry. You know, I mean, that's a 12-point gap, and even your top three are only 4 points away.
I don't think the guy that's 12 points down at this point right now is like, oh, my season's over. But in the lights class, if you're 26 points down, you're like, holy hell.
Yeah. And that's kind of what I was getting at, is that I could see these top seven, top eight guys in the 450 class thinking, you know, hey, I'm still in this. You know, 12 points is not enough. We all saw what happened last year. I mean, Coop goes down in Nashville when he's in the title hunt the very next weekend. Tomac goes down.
He was the leader.
When he was the points leader, and then it ends up, you know, three rounds to go, the only three guys that were in it, Chase ends up winning the title. Not saying it was handed it to him, because you have to be there for the whole season to be able to win it. But I think in the 450 class, these top eight guys that are only 12 points apart are thinking that they're still in this title hunt.
Yeah.
I think for the fifth place guy in the 250 class, man, I'm a full race down right now. I need multiple guys ahead of me to DNF or have a really bad race to try and get back into this thing. If that makes sense.
Yes. I think, I mean, it's so early though. We have to keep into perspective, like, It's only the third or fourth round at this point. I mean,
yeah,
it's so early.
Well, for the 450 class, it is. You know, for the 450 class, we're only three rounds in. 250 class, totally different animal.
Yeah.
You know, 250 class, you've got only four races left, right? So they're halfway through their season. 450s has just started. So they got a long way to go.
I'm still not seeing the reasoning to just throw it away like RJ did. I just don't get it.
Well, it was also slick. So we got to, again, just like I said in these.
I would love to see the replay of that too.
The first you three rounds, I think everything, the first three rounds, there's been something that you could say that has affected each round. A1, jitters, or San Francisco, complete mudder, San Diego, mud starts during the night program, makes the track slick. I think there's something that affects all three rounds.
Yeah.
If we had three dry, perfectly tracked, perfect races, and these were your results, I would be completely blown away. I would say this is a much different season than we've ever seen before. But I think due to track conditions and each race having its own scenario, I think this thing's going to start to settle in here with some dry races, and we'll really see where people are, and the points will start to show.
Hey, Duke, I know you love the coverage of the Supercross. What did you think of the drone instead of the cable cam?
I like the drone.
Yeah?
Yeah. There was more than one drone there, because sometimes you'd be watching the drone and all of a sudden another one would fly by.
Yeah. I'm thinking the drone's cheaper production-wise than a cable cam.
I'm assuming just with setup.
Just the setup, too.
I think you can, yeah. Most of these stadiums have the cable already there.
Do you think a drone will ever affect the outcome of a race?
I don't think so.
I mean, you could always crash it.
That's what I'm saying. Like,
yeah.
I think it doesn't look as good.
I was testing with Star one time, and somebody flew the drone right into Cooper.
Nice.
He went over a jump, and the drone flew right into him, hit his hand, and then hit him in the chest.
So there is a possibility.
He was not a happy camper.
I mean, if you have a hungover pilot, you know, and he's just like, oh, man, I'm tired, dude, and just lets it loose, like, it could affect the outcome of a race. Yeah.
I do think it affects quality. It looks way worse.
You think it looks worse than the...
Yeah, it looks way worse. It's like not a broadcast camera. It's just the drone mounted camera that they're live feeding. And,
yeah.
You know.
I guess what I like about the drone, because when it follows behind them, the regular cam, I guess, covers more area. I don't know.
I think that was Jade Dungey's. Maybe I'm wrong. Jade Dungey's first win as a mechanic too.
Oh really?
I think so.
At KTM.
Why? Where else? Where did he get a win at?
He was his first 450 win, because he was Chase's mechanic for.
Oh, you're right. You're right. Never mind.
Chase's, yeah.
Never mind.
Jade's a pretty good friend of mine. And
I can't get over Justin Barsh's podium performances. The guy really needs to take acting classes, because you can totally tell the Red Bull has nothing in it, but he acts like he drinks it. And you can tell he never swallows. And it's like, dude, just put some water in there or something. Like, it looks, he does it three times on the podium today. I studied it, rewound it. And he drinks out the side of his mouth like this, you know? And you can tell there's nothing coming out of the can.
I don't really pay that much attention to it.
I do. It's like, come on, man. Like, put some water in there or something. It just, I mean, if we're still going, it's about to happen right now. But I'm like, dude, like, you need to actually swallow, so it looks like you're really drinking a Red Bull.
Well, we've got the race, you know. Obviously, it just finished on here, and one of our great sponsors, Oakley. You know, it's good to see Aaron Plessinger with the Oakley goggles, and Aaron Kane, and everybody over at Oakley getting that win last night. You know, AP's first one. Super excited for him, his whole family. AP's a great guy, and you know, just takes the time out. That's why he's a fan favorite. And the stadium was so loud that last lap. I mean, you could hear it on the broadcast how much everybody was cheering when he was in those last couple corners and when he crossed the finish line. I mean, just raw emotion, you know, a real down-to-earth dude, and does so much for the fans. I think that's why he's, you know, easily one of the fan favorites. But before we get to our picks of A2 after watching these first three rounds, I want to take just a second to thank Extreme Power Sports in Tampa. Right off of 301, just south of State Road 60, Extreme Power Sports of Tampa sells Honda, GasGas, and Husqvarna, Polaris. They've got great parts. I know Duke was down there this week picking up some parts from them. That's where we're getting our bikes from right now, these new Hondas that are coming through. We're having some great success and enjoying the Hondas. We did not do a podcast last weekend because we were at the Winter-Am race at the Dade City Winter-Am. That's one of the closest one to us. This weekend, the Gatorback Winter-Am going on, but cold.
30 degrees this morning at 8 o'clock there.
Oh, that'd be miserable.
Yeah.
Mm-mm.
Yeah, miserable. So we're going to continue to try and get these episodes out to you as quickly as we can, as soon as the races are over, and continue to knock them out. But a huge thank you to Extreme Power Sports. Want to thank our good friends at Fox, everything that they do for us with the gear, boots, helmets, even our swag. You can see that Tyler on his camera has got his nice team factory Fox jacket on.
It's RJ's. I stole it.
Hey, wait a minute.
Plus, I didn't get no credit last week because my rider won.
How many weeks in a row? How many episodes is Duke going to wear that shirt?
Every episode.
Well, the Bucks are playing today, so
I got like four or five of them.
Hey, that is true. Four or five of them. I am excited, Duke, as well, that the Bucks are playing.
The Bucks
today.
Are playing today. He wore a sweatshirt.
Well, this afternoon I have Baker Mayfield sweatshirt on.
And you know what's crazy is the Bucks are playing in Detroit, where the Supercross will be not next weekend, but after Anaheim 2, they'll be in Detroit. So the same stadium the Bucks are playing in today in the playoff game, they will be racing.
They'll be at the Supercross, yeah.
Racing there in 2 weeks.
Is that a East round?
I think it is. I think that's the first
East round.
The first East round. It's Detroit.
I'd like to go.
Baker Mayfield.
Is that a new stadium? I can't remember. Is the Detroit stadium?
15 years over. No, it's an older one now.
Yeah. Oh, okay. What is the newest stadium? Indy? I'd like to go to the stadium.
Lucas Oil is a nice stadium.
Lucas Oil is amazing.
I'd like to go to the nicest. RJ, take us to the nicest Supercross stadium and get us a suite, please.
That's Dallas.
I was going to say the only ones that I could think of would be Indy or Dallas.
Look. Nothing in that can, bud. Nothing. Wait, he does it like three times.
I know he does. Last one, he polishes it off, though. Watch.
Yeah, he finishes it.
But he tilts it all the way upside down. Yeah. It's like there's nothing left in there, bud.
It doesn't say W. They used to put a W on the bottom of them.
I like the
nice.
The factory pilot, the Oakley factory pilot there. Another Oakley rider there, yep. Justin Barsha up on the podium. So good for them. But, again, huge thanks to Oakley, Fox, Extreme Power Sports. Can't thank them enough for everything they do for us. All right, here we go. A2 picks. After seeing what we've seen in these first three rounds, we've had people all over the map. Thrasher is not there at A1, but ends up winning in San Diego. RJ wins A1, but has two tough races in the mud. AP grabs his first win. Sexton dominates in the mud in San Francisco, and Jet wins a dry A1. So, I mean, seeing...
And don't forget, A2 is a triple crown.
Oh, is it?
Mm-hmm.
I forgot about that. We did that last year. We went out to A2 for the triple crown.
Right.
That makes it more exciting.
You went out there last year.
I can stay awake a lot easier for triple crown formats.
Really?
Yeah, because
why is that?
Because you have the racing starting right at the beginning, you know, instead of heat races, and then you get to the LCQ. I usually always fall asleep right around the LCQ mark.
Hmm.
So he's not very entertained.
No, he's not.
His attention is not caught.
And you know,
he knows the coverage is not good.
You're stuck watching it on Peacock, so you can't change the channel unless you want to go like completely out of it. And
right.
Well, then you got to watch, you know, 10 minutes of the Science of Supercross, which is retarded to me. But
you know, I kind of
I like them.
I like them.
Some of them are pretty informative.
Yeah.
I prefer makeup to mud, but I like them.
Yeah. Exactly.
Well, you guys all like it. I don't. Well, I'd rather just watch the dang racing, man.
Look at what we're going in the background.
I'd rather just watch the racing.
Well, I think for me, the problem is that anybody that knows me personally knows that for our work, I wake up pretty early for work and get out the door. And I'm not typically a nighttime guy. I don't typically stay up very late. And these West Coast rounds, I am very grateful that they have moved them now to, you know, 8 p.m. or 8:30 p.m. start times.
Greatest thing Feld ever did.
Yeah. I mean, that's huge for us on the East Coast, because when they were 10 p.m. start times, there's most of the time I wouldn't even get to the 450 heat races, you know? I mean, that's just too late. But I appreciate them moving them forward, because now at least I get to watch some of them, and then the very first thing I do in the morning is turn them on and turn on the replay and watch it, you know, three times over, just like today. This is probably the third time that we've watched the mains all the way through. But let's wrap this up. Picks for A2.
Who's going first?
Go for it.
Is it me?
Yeah, go for it.
Oh, my picks are always trash.
Well, and right now we're assuming it's a dry
If I assume it's a it's a triple crown.
You don't get credit for it. You don't get a.
You know who's really good at triple crowns? I think is Tomac. He's pretty good at triple crowns, isn't he?
Are we just picking 450s?
Well, I'm starting off with 450s, but at the same time, I think Coop's. I think Coop's demeanor, his confidence. He knows he could win. I'm gonna pick Coop for number one on Saturday. Cooper
yeah.
Webb.
Yeah, I could see that.
Yeah,
I think he's gonna be hungry.
And I think Lawrence will get second. Chase third. Anderson fourth. And a Plessinger fifth.
Okay. I mean, it's not bad. It's not a bad lineup at all. It's pretty solid. Those guys have been there. That's your 450s.
Lights. I'm going to go with my boy Kitchen again. What are you shaking your head at me for?
I have an itch.
Why? Is his Triple Crown record terrible?
No. Good choice, my man.
I think I'm going to go with Kitchen, and then I'm going to go with Hampshire, Thrasher Smith.
Thrasher? Okay.
And then Smith. And then for P5, let's throw in Oldenburg, man. He had a good weekend. Mm-hmm. I think he's going to go into A2 feeling good about himself.
Yeah, not bad. Not bad. Duke, you want to go?
Yeah. What do you want first, 250 or 450?
Either one. I'm going to write both of them down. I'm putting them all down. Right,
450?
On
you want blonde or brunette?
Duke. I like that redhead. I like the redhead. First, Chase Sexton. Second, Cooper Webb. Third will probably be Hunter Lawrence.
Ooh.
Fourth, Dylan Ferrandis.
Ooh.
All right, let's get you to bed.
Fifth.
Let's get you to bed, Grandpa.
Oh, I'll tell you a little story about breakfast yesterday morning. Fifth, Jet Lawrence.
Fifth.
It could be Jet Lawrence / Tomac.
You can't do slashes.
Yeah, they can't tie.
Well, I should get a bye because, like I've said three times already, I got no credit for the win last week.
So are you saying that Tomac is going, they're going to come together in the last turn and Tomac's going to end up like on Jet's seat and they're going to tie for fifth because they both go over the line at the same exact time on the same bike?
Buddy system.
On the same bike.
Not the
buddy. Buddy system.
Has that ever happened? Maybe next weekend. Maybe.
You know, they always had. There's always that
crazy shit going on out there.
There's always that story of that rider. It was back in like the LA Coliseum in the early 90s. Duke, you may remember this, where the rider crashed and he crashed and landed on somebody else's bike. Nobody has any footage of it, or does anybody know what I'm talking about? Or
I've never heard that one.
Maybe I need to go to bed. All right,
you need to go to bed.
What if Tomac ends up in Jet's back wheel and he's stuck in between the fender and the back wheel and he goes over the finish line? Is that a tie?
I don't know.
Or is it the transponder?
Yeah,
transponder that has to finish?
And we'll discuss that.
Is it the rider that has to finish or the transponder?
I'll pull your helmet down.
Yeah.
You yank on my neck?
I got a neck.
I didn't know Jason Anderson was a chiropractor.
I didn't know he was. 250s. I'm going to go with Joe Shimoda for the win.
Wow.
Levi Kitchen second. RJ Hampshire third. Jordan Smith fourth. And Nate Thrasher fifth. My man, Ryder D, I don't know what happened to him, but he had a good heat.
So do you think... Dookie, do you think that the do you think that the Hunter Lawrence and Shimoda thing, the work in progress, is going to get all figured out this week?
It'll get closer.
Closer?
Yeah.
You put Hunter in the top three.
I totally agree with what they're doing there. That makes total sense what they're doing.
What are they doing?
Well, they're developing the bike and him as they go along.
Right.
Lars said the same. Lars said it. It's a work in progress, because you know, Jet's already been on a 450 outdoor. He knows what it does. He knows what to expect. Hunter's never been on one till beginning of Supercross.
Mm-hmm.
All right, Tyler.
Man, it's such a crapshoot. I don't even. Tomac for 450s overall. We'll go Tomac, Webb, Jet.
Mm-hmm.
Anderson.
Wow.
Mm-hmm.
That's where I made the mistake. I forgot. My man Anderson.
I put him on my list.
Let me have my own wild card pick. I'm gonna go with give me just a Roczen for fifth. I was gonna say like Justin Cooper for fifth.
I honestly think
just because it was a triple crown, you know?
That's another one. Dang.
The triple crown thing messes me up,
yeah,
honestly.
That's what messes me up, too. I forgot.
Yeah, but I'm going to go Roczen.
I picked mine. Can I do a redo?
All right.
No, well, I honestly need to study
starters.
Well, yeah, starters, which Kenny's been killing the starts.
Yeah.
But
look at your heat race winners.
Anderson.
Your heat race winners are your starters and guys that are going to perform in the short motos.
Like, who has the best record? You know, do they keep those stats? Who has the best record for triple crown formats?
I don't know.
Go on Racer X and ask.
Yeah.
They've got that geek.
So, yeah, I'm going to go.
They have a geek
Roczen,
over there?
They have a geek.
Roczen out the top five. What place does Roczen get Saturday if his bike's electric start?
Oh.
Why would it be electric start?
I'm just saying.
Oh, I thought they were making a change.
No, because of him going down.
Because he went down. Three kicks and had to fire.
Listen, that
and find neutral.
That was his race right there. But you know,
250s is just I don't know.
Just
like give me a Jordan Smith, Nate Thrasher. I'm really doing the Yamaha's service
this
weekend. Jordan Smith.
Well, the Yamahas are great starters. I mean, those bikes have power. And if you look at the starters of this weekend, you know, a Yamaha in a triple crown format's probably a solid choice.
Hampshire third, Shimoda fourth, Kitchen fifth. I really have no idea.
Okay. Tyler Rattray gave me a bunch of static this week when I see him, because I was on a Honda. He told me I should buy Yamahas.
All right. Well, I'm gonna go on my top five. I'm gonna go
Tyler Rattray.
I'm gonna go CW2, just because I think he's fired up after this weekend and what went down. So I think he's there. I'm gonna put Jet in second, AP in third, with some confidence of the win, and he's typically been a pretty good starter, and he's the current points leader, which means he's been up there at every race. I'm going to put Chase Sexton in fourth, and I'm going to put Eli Tomac in fifth. As far as my lights go, I'm going to do my man, who I think can be there when he doesn't put it on two wheels, and hopefully we don't have a mutter and go back to the same way he performed at A1, and that's going to be RJ Hampshire in first, and then the points leader Jordan Smith in second, Nate Thrasher in third, Levi Kitchen in fourth, and my wild card on the 250 is going to be Garrett Marchbanks.
I like that.
In fifth.
Mm-hmm. I like that.
So nobody put Kenny on their list?
Kenny is on Tyler's list.
Oh, okay.
Now
for P5. For P5.
For B5.
Yep.
I want to redo.
Yep. Now, Duke, yours is set. Duke's probably got the most of the wild card there, with having Hunter in third and Dylan Ferrandis in fourth. Probably the most wild card pick. But I think Shane and I have a pretty similar pick, outside of you have Anderson and I have Tomac.
Mm-hmm.
So, which kind of similar.
Kenny's going to win it, though.
He very well could.
I don't know why I didn't pick him.
Same here. I didn't put
Been crushing the starts.
Yeah.
Winning heat races.
And wasn't he the fastest qualifier this weekend?
Yes, he was.
Kenny?
Yep.
Fastest qualifier.
You would have never known it if you're watching TV.
That is a super. If you were going to put an asterisk on anything, the fastest qualifier last week is definitely one of the things I would. They didn't get a second one, right? No adjustments could be made to the bike. It's.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure Kitchen won a Triple Crown last year.
I think you're right.
I think I'm pretty accurate on that one.
Well, we'll find out as we have Anaheim 2 coming up next weekend. We'll try and continue to get these podcasts out to you. This is episode 38. You got myself, RJ Huss, Mr. Sugar Shane, Dave Dookie, and Tyler Kasha. Please make sure to share with your friends. Let everybody know where they can listen to us. Spotify, Apple Podcasts, YouTube, directly on our website. Wherever you want to listen to your podcast at, you can find it there. But make sure to follow along, like us on Instagram, all the social media channels, and please hit the subscribe button. A huge thank you to Extreme Power Sports down in Tampa, our good friends over at Fox and Oakley. Can't thank them enough for everything they do for us. Episode 38 in the books. Anything you want to close out, boys?
Nope. See you next weekend.
Hey, Doogie, I hope your Bucks win today.
Baker Mayfield.
See ya.